Hi there, my name is Annie Lalla. I'm a love and relationship coach, and welcome to this video. Today I want to talk about the ego, and I want to talk about dignity and shame and how that helps and hinders us in a romantic relationship. Now, I'm sure if you're like me, you've had interactions with a romantic partner where you reflected accurately back to them a piece of their crazy, their blind spot, a behavior pattern that is suboptimal and holding them back from their greatest self. And we've gotten pushback. And they've said, they've argued or they're defended, or they said, that's your crazy, or no one else says that about me. And first of all, let's just handle the no one else says that about me. That, I just wanna say, as someone who works with relationships and couples, the thing your partner complains about in you that nobody else complains about is actually valid in a strange way, because the way you behave your romantic partner is like a special case of relationship. It's not the same laws of physics that you use for all your other relationships. So of course you won't do all those crazies in your other relationships because they're not your attachment figures. They don't bring up your early attachment wounds and call on the darker, more younger parts of your psyche. So oftentimes the complaints that our romantic partners give us are clues, are golden clues to hidden aspects of our persona and our behavior that we wouldn't get access to anywhere else because it doesn't show up in any of our other relationships. So when your partner has a recurrent complaint, you want to get curious about it and try on that they are fumbling, but trying to show you something that's holding you back from your own growth. Now, they might not have the best bedside manner. They might not be phrasing it in the most inspiring way, but often with recurrent criticism, there is a grain of truth behind what they're saying, and there's a commitment to your growth that's lurking behind the complaint. So you want to be on the hunt for that. But let's get back to dignity. Okay, we know what ego is, right? Ego is our sense of like our persona, our personality. It's loosely our sense of self, but it's the part I'm talking about is the constructed self, the persona that we construct to survive in the world based on our early childhood experiences, our fears, our insecurities, our shames. There's all kinds of things that we're trying to avoid being bad and wrong and how to get love and approval. All these things shape our personality, okay? It's almost like when we were young, we were like these sapling trees, and unwittingly, our parents and our culture shapes the sapling tree like a bonsai, like unwittingly binds certain parts of the branches and the trunk so that who we become is this kind of stunted, not fully expressed version of who we could have been. And that stunted, not fully expressed version, the version of ourself that evolved on the back of trying to get love and approval and avoid shame and pain, it's this front-facing facade, it's the persona. And I'm just loosely calling that the ego. And so we all construct one, and we wield it and hold it and defend it as if it was our very life, okay? Human beings are the only animal that defends our beliefs, ideas, and identity with the same rigor and vigor as a trapped animal defends their physical life, okay? Humans will die for an idea. I don't think any other animals would die for an idea. And this is at the root of what makes humans magnificent and horrific. But let's get back to, okay, so humans create an identity that is constructed, right? It's constructed as an attempt to get love and approval and avoid shame, blame, and pain. And everyone's persona is different. And I think we're born with genetic predispositions as well, but we're just talking about the constructed persona. Because we defend our identity the way we would defend a cherished tenet or belief, we get very protective and defensive of our identity. And so when a romantic partner or a friend or family member reflects back to us something that is not consistent with the identity that we've constructed or is at odds with who we want to be or see ourselves as, it can be assaulting and horrifying. And the first instinct in us is to not believe it, is to deny it and to defend. And often it's because we're ashamed. You know, if there's an aspect of you that someone reflects that is something you've spent your whole life not trying not to do, Okay, let's see. I don't know. I talk a lot about shame and the toxicity of it. And I really do my best to not shame people I love and clients into changing. But I'm like the rest of us. I'm flawed and fallible. And sometimes I unwittingly shame. Like I might roll my eye at my husband, or I don't know. There's tones of voice that my husband has literally told me, Annie, why are you shaming me right now? You said you don't like to shame. And I'm like, I don't know. I was shaming. It's totally invisible to me because, as I've said in other videos, self-deception evolved to make deceptions of others congruent. Okay. And so when we do something that's inconsistent with our identity, we're ashamed of it. So it gets buried in our unconscious and our shadow and marginalized. So it comes out in weird moments where our partner can clearly see it, but we can't. That's part of why we hire our partner, to be a sacred mirror of not only our magnificence, but our shadow. So we have to listen to them when they reflect that back, as if they're offering us a gift. But if you or your partner feel ashamed at a reflection that you're getting back from the world, because it's inconsistent with who you see yourself to be, one of the things that's great to do, and say you're doing this to your partner, you're showing them something they don't want to see, it's in their blind spot, what you might want to do is put some creativity and intentionality into how to give them an out from the shame. How can you help create a narrative or a story that contextualizes their suboptimal, that's not me behavior in a way that allows them to retain their dignity, right? Instead of shaming them and confronting them, you lied to me, you said XYZ, and then I found out ABC, and then you're a bad person and you lied to me. Like, if you could be like, you know, you said XYZ, and then I found out ABC, and I started thinking, like, I know you love me, and I know you want us to be transparent and connected. So you must have felt really uncomfortable or really confused or really worried for you to withhold that information from me, for you to deceive me. And you want to phrase your accusation or your confrontation in a way that gives your partner, the person you love, a way out of that scenario with some dignity, with their dignity intact, with their esteem not eroded. Because if they have eroded dignity and esteem, they're going to have even less resource to then build a more extraordinary version of themselves. You're asking them to iterate who they are at the next level, but you're then stealing from them their belief in themselves, their self-esteem, and their own dignity. And it's hard to build a new self when you're ashamed of the one your partner's reflecting back. So rather than shaming your partner into change, you want to inspire them and motivate them to align with their highest values by reflecting to them, you know, partner, I know you value honesty. I know you want to be transparent with me, and I know you love me. And I know for you to have withheld that piece of information, you must have been really suffering. You must have been scared. You must have been in pain. And you offer them an opportunity to take responsibility for their faux pas, but in a way that retains their dignity, their esteem, and allows them to stay loving who they are. Okay, you don't want to strip away their self-love. The last thing you want is your partner going, yeah, I'm a loser. I can't believe I did that. I'm so awful. Like, that's the whole point of you loving a person, is so that they fall more in love with themselves and their life. So you don't want to help them fall in love with their self and their life on one hand, and then steal away all their self-esteem and their dignity on the other. And as romantic partners, we often do that without realizing, right? Our job in romantic relationships is to help our partner love their current reality of who they are so much that they're inspired to iterate at the next level with your suggestions of how they can match their most greatest version of themselves. You gotta love them as they are and offer them opportunities to aspire into their greatest self. And if they're shamed and made wrong and stripped of their own beauty, either in your eyes or their eyes, they don't have a wherewithal to make the change. So anyways, to summarize, I would invite you to be on the lookout for your partner's hidden shame. It's usually in their defensiveness, in their argument back when you give them some information. And allow them, it's almost like give them an opportunity to take responsibility for the thing that you want them to see, but do so in a way that they feel bigger and better for doing it rather than smaller and shamier and worse. So make it safer for them to own up to their crazy behavior rather than for them to get an onslaught of even more attack and shame when they say, yeah, I did that. Okay? Because then what you're doing is teaching them to not bring the truth to you. You're teaching them that when they own up to something, you launch into more attack. That's not what we want to encourage. So hope that makes sense. Okay? Your dignity is sacred, and so is your partner's. So you want to conserve both of them. And when you attack and shame your partner, you erode not just their dignity, but yours as well. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something. Leave me any questions or comments below. And give me some likes. Thanks. Bye-bye.